time I caught you undressing me with your eyes, I'd be your rich woman, then I could prove all my senses were real and all along. You wanted me to, so now you laugh and call me a fool. I know you wanted me to before she got to you. I would say that we were something special to behold, but now it's over, all over. For she came barging through, we were proud to make the kind of love as good as falling clover. Did she barge in and steal your heart away? Or did you know from the first day I was just someone to play? If so, damn, that's cold.
That's good. We're starting in 2 minutes, but if the music winds up on the live stream, we get shut down. So that's why it stopped before we're starting. Yeah. Thank you.
Welcome to all of you. I'm so delighted to see so many of you here. I'm Suzanne Goldberg. I'm the Executive Vice President for University Life at Columbia, and a special welcome to, of course, everybody in the room, everybody on the live stream, and with great thanks for our panelists for being here today. Today's conversation, Awakening Our Democracy, Ferguson, Charleston, and Beyond, is actually the second in the Awakening Our Democracy series at Columbia. This is a new series which focuses on race, ethnicity, disparities, justice, and other pressing issues of our day. And it is sponsored by the Office of University Life with co-sponsors from throughout the university. I encourage you to take a look at your programs or on the web to see the many co-sponsors that we have for the series. Our aim, both today and more broadly for this series, is to create a space at the university level, a university-wide space for thoughtful engagement and conversation about the issues of our time, especially related to race, ethnicity, disparities, and justice. And you can find the live stream from our first conversation, which was Awakening Our Democracy, the American Dream, Immigration, and Belonging, on the University Life website, which is at universitylife.columbia.edu. With thanks to our panelists, on the website you can also find a terrific selection, a thought-provoking selection of readings and viewings, and I encourage you to check them out. And also a sampling of questions submitted by audience members today that will be part of the conversation. As part of the Awakening Our Democracy series, we also invite each of you in the room and everybody watching to submit your thoughts to the Office of University Life. We're creating a space in the Ideas and Action section of our website for ongoing conversation, a kind of digital conversation in between the in-person forums to enable continuous thinking and engagement on these issues. And our aim, again, with this series is to engage difficult and challenging questions, to have thought-provoking conversation, and to do that in the context of a university that encourages thoughtful learning and exchange about the wide range of issues we deal with here, and particularly the issues of our day. So if you're inspired, please send us a post that we can post to the University Life website. We'll also be posting a selection of what we receive to the Office of University Life's Twitter feed and Facebook pages, so you can get your ideas out there, and we encourage you and invite you to do that. Today's conversation, Ferguson, Charleston, and Beyond, at the intersection of race, violence, policing, and community safety, couldn't come at a more important time. I want to extend our special thanks to Barbara Arnwine. Barbara, if you could just wave. Barbara is president and CEO of Igniting Change, and until recently, the longtime executive director of the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law, and Barbara helped us conceive this series, so thank you, Barbara. We're fortunate today also to have a terrific moderator and three wonderful panelists in conversation, so I'll introduce them each briefly. They each have tremendously long resumes. We've given you a longer snippet in your programs and on the web, so please check that out. And of course, if you Google any of them, you will find much, much more. To my left is our moderator, our Columbia Law School professor, Kimberlé Crenshaw. Professor Crenshaw co-founded and directs the executive director of the African American Policy Forum, a gender and racial justice think tank. She also created the Say Her Name campaign, which we'll hear more about shortly. Next to Kim is Mychal Skolnik, a major participant in many national conversations about social justice and race, and president and editor-in-chief of Global Grind News, which was created by hip-hop entrepreneur Russell Simmons. Mychal also works with the Trayvon Martin Foundation, the Drug Policy Alliance, and Dot to Dot, a youth leadership summit. Maya Wiley, next to Mychal Skolnik, is counsel to the mayor of New York City, Bill de Blasio. Maya advises the mayor on a very wide range of issues, I think it's fair to say, and leads and serves on many of the city's most important boards. Maya is a Columbia Law School alum and also founder of the Center for Social Inclusion, and has litigated and lobbied Congress to transform structural racism. Next to Maya is Mychal Denzel Smith. Mychal Denzel Smith is a social commentator, author, and contributing writer at The Nation. At The Nation, he is also a Nobler Fellow of Journalism. Mychal's work in numerous publications covers race, politics, mental health, feminism, black male identity, and many more topics. So I encourage you to check out his work as well. Please join me in welcoming all of our panelists. And Kim, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Suzanne, and good afternoon to everyone who's here in the room with us and those who are joining us virtually. I think it's safe to say that this has been a year like no other in recent memory. So for the first time in, I would say, a generation, we've witnessed a sustained conversation about race and racism as it plays out principally in relationship to the killings of black men and women by the police, but more broadly about some of the ways in which bodies and borders and identities have been subject to policing, both state policing and private policing as well. So some of the names are household names to us that mark this moment. So we all know Mike Brown and Eric Garner or Tamir Rice. But along with those names are the names of nine other people who lost their lives in Charleston as they were praying, killed by Dylann Roof. And in particular, his comments that you must go were not unfamiliar to people of color and to immigrants who face claims that in one way or another, they don't fit in this nation. They either need to be pushed out of our country or pushed into prisons in order to make us, the broader us, safer. Now, these sentiments that at one point were off of the mainstream have bubbled into the mainstream through some of the presidential debates, as many people have heard certain candidates make claims against groups as a whole, stereotypes that at some point might not have been articulated so directly in the middle of political debate. And so we think that democracy is usually a self-correcting fix to these problems. But even in the Democratic arena, we see efforts to suppress voting and to push people out of the electoral campaign. So there are a lot of pressing issues for us to talk about, many ways in which our democracy is actually being threatened by many of these issues. So they're vexing questions, and it really requires us to have a conversation between activists, between our white allies, and with those who work in government. So we're really fortunate to have members from each of those constituencies here. So what we're hoping for is a conversation. It's going to be prompted by a series of questions. Each of our panelists, in the interest of having a conversation, have agreed to give about 2-minute answers to each of the questions. And then eventually, we're going to turn the conversation out to you all. So let's begin. So it's said that a picture is sometimes worth 1,000 words. And so instead of an 1,000 word introduction, I'm going to ask each of you to share a picture, a snapshot of something that happened over the last year that in your sense captures what the current crisis is about, something that really encapsulates it. So just as an example, historically, the picture of Bull Connor with the dogs and the fire hoses trained on marching school children in the 60s. That was a picture that captured for many people the critical dimension of the civil rights movement. It spread across the world. Now, of course, there was much more behind it that people used as a subtitle to say what this was about. But if you were to choose a moment over the last 18 months that you think with your subtitles can explain what's happening, I'd love to know it. And we have two Michaels, so I'm gonna say Mychal DS for the first one. Oh, DS, okay, so I'll hit you up with DS. So DS, let's start with you.
Well, a few images stick out. I think the very first one that a lot of us were familiar with was when everything first started in Ferguson, and they were throwing the tear gas, and then the brother picked it up, and he's like, he's got a bag of chips in his hand, and he's still holding, and he's throwing the tear gas canister back at him, and I think that that's just emblematic of what resistance looks like, particularly now, in an age where people are sort of dismissing the idea of respectability politics. His brother in dreadlocks is holding his bag of chips and throwing a tear gas canister back at the police. But the thing that I've seen that really encapsulates this moment for me and what's meaningful about now was when I went to Ferguson for the 1 year anniversary of the killing of Mychal Brown. And just that whole weekend when people were in the streets and people are marching and people are chanting, seeing the children who were just so carefree, running around with shirts off and just like doing a whip and nay-nay and all of that type of stuff, like just the idea that they're growing up in a time period in which someone is saying your life matters, like that's a revolution unto itself. But to that point, what I mostly saw was young black boys running around carefree and grown black women doing the marching and the chanting. And I wonder, in that context, are those young boys growing up to appreciate who is fighting for them? And will they then show up to fight for them when it's their time?
And we'll come back around to some of the implications of that observation when we talk a little bit about intersectionality in terms of the social moment. So Maya, what snapshot captures it all for you?
So what captured it all for me was the black woman who climbed the flagpole in South Carolina and pulled that flag down and got arrested for it because it had the Confederate flag. And this is a battle that, from on one level, is so symbolic. And I think the symbolism, not just of what that flag represented and this notion that you could have as your state symbol, something that actually represented chattel slavery and white supremacy, and actually be able to wrap it in a narrative that suggested that it was not racist, that ignored history, and it actually ignored the way, as a symbol, it continued to represent for black people in South Carolina and across the country the ways in which we continue to be excluded symbolically and practically from democracy. And the fact that this woman was able to, one, as a female, right, because it's that level, traditionally in the civil rights movement, it would have been a young black college male student, right? And if it was an anti-war movement, it would have been a young white male student. And in this instance, being a black female, I thought was particularly powerful because so much of the leadership that we have seen that has formed the movement around Black Lives Matter is black, female, and lesbian.
Mychal.
So I'm deeply inspired by the turnout. Of young people in this room. So it's, you come to these things, you're not really sure if anyone's gonna show up. And the turnout is really amazing. So it's humbling to be in your presence and to be in this amazing institution of learning and knowledge. I was a filmmaker before I started working for Russell for 12 years. So images matter a lot. I think a lot about Emmett Till's mother. And showing the face of Emmett in the casket in Jet magazine to the world. And
Mychal, say a little bit more about who Emmett Till was.
Sure, Emmett Till was a young boy from Chicago who was in Mississippi visiting his cousins, who allegedly whistled at a white woman in a convenience store, a little small convenience store. And then the next day, the family of the woman came and lynched him. And he was 14 years old, and the photograph in Jet magazine was an open casket. His mother wanted the world to see this, his face, which looked unbelievably deformed and not even human. But I think in the present time, Walter Scott on the cover of the New York Times, seeing him get shot in the back by a police officer in South Carolina, as a white male. On this panel, and living in this city and growing up in this city, we haven't believed black people, and we don't. And I say we, me included. I put myself in that we. We hear stories, and we think, oh, it can't be that bad, or really, like, did it really happen like that? Are you sure he's innocent? Are you sure he didn't have anything on him? And that moment when you see Walter Scott on the cover of the New York Times, talk about structural racism and how to dismantle it, right? Part of our structural racism is in who controls the messaging and in who controls the stories that are being told. And then the New York Times putting it on the cover, and white people, like in my family, in my communities, saying, I believe it. Maybe he was 100% innocent. He got shot in the back, and the cop then puts a taser or some weapon on top of him, and I believe it. I think that's a turning point for us as white people to begin to say, wow, they are telling the truth.
So of all of your opening snapshots, two were snapshots of resistance, transformation in progress, and another was a snapshot of the problem is real, right? It's not just imaginary. Now, I guess for the first two, the question might be asked, why now? Why at this moment? Particularly given the fact that, you know, many of us can remember cases of police killings. Here it was Eleanor Bumpers or Amadou Diallo. I mean, the list goes on and on. But something about this moment seems to be galvanizing. So what's your speculation about why now? And I'll start with you, Maya.
I just want to ask how many people knew Mychal was white before.
Until today.
Until today. I remember when I found out Mychal was white. Sorry, I had to say that, Mychal.
This was,
it was worth it. The important thing I think for us to realize is that we have had literally a period of time in which we have had both the historic symbolic moment of the first black president to be elected president of the United States, coupled with incredible backlash to undermining a Democrat, not just a democratically elected, but democratically elected with a mandate in 2008, and an incredible backlash against him that was clearly racialized in the form of the birther movement and so many other things, but also coming on the heels of incredible economic dislocation that affected folks across the spectrum and was cumulative, building from, you know, so I am talking about the Great Recession, which for some communities was the Great Depression all over again, really undermining and unraveling the middle class. And I think what we have seen historically, including in the Civil Rights Movement, is the Civil Rights Movement did not start in 1954, y'all. It started as abolition of slavery, and it never stopped. But what happens when you have a confluence of conditions that aren't just about the demand, but also about the underlying conditions that help all of us see our connectedness, and all of us feel our dislocation, and all of us see the ways in which systems may not be working. There were so many and have been so many symbols for us economically, socially, and politically that something in our democracy is not working. That I think these violent and clearly morally reprehensible moments become flashpoints that are like a match that drops on a tinderbox.
Yes, I see you're ready to go.
Yeah, everything Maya said, but it's also important to note who showed up to vote for Obama. Because young black people showed up in record numbers to vote for Obama, to vote for hope, and to vote for change, and they didn't see it. They saw the same script play out over and over again. Now, it wasn't as if people were expecting the election of Obama to like solve all the problems, but we were expecting steps of progress, and we saw none of that. We continue to see young black people get gunned down in the streets. We continue to see that police repression. And at some point, and I think Trayvon Martin was the breaking point for so many people, because I mean, Oscar Grant was killed not even a month after we elected Obama.
That's right.
And the streets of Oakland lit up.
That's right.
But then you try to give it a chance. It's like, here's supposed to be a new America. But then Trayvon Martin was killed. And then George Zimmerman got away with it. What else were we supposed to do? What else were we supposed to do at Step Take to the Streets and start breaking things?
So, DS, while you have the mic, take the next step in and walk us through Black Lives Matter, in particular, the behind-the-scenes meaning and moment of declaring Black Lives Matter. There is a move being made there to center anti-Black racism. So what's behind that move? And of course I'm going to ask, what do you think of the All Lives Matter counter to that move?
Well, of course you have to center anti-Black racism because that's the cornerstone of American democracy, right? Like, that is what we've built this on. The idea of Blackness as second class, of Black people as second class citizens, is what keeps this democracy churning in the way that it does and ensures that the people who possess the power and privilege maintain it. As long as you can define Blackness as the thing that is undesirable, then you can adopt new people into the system all the time, and as long as that remains the same people, the rich, white, leading male elites will always maintain power because they will be able to deceive you into believing that the competition is to not be Black. And so, yes, it's important to then say Black lives matter and use that as a counter to the system of white supremacy to establish that we are not second-class citizens. We do deserve equal treatment under the law, but equality more broadly. And the count, like, all lives matter. No shit. But if I have to say Black Lives Matter, obviously we aren't living in conditions where all lives do matter.
So Mychal, let me bring this back around to you. Pretty soon, a lot of folks are going to be going home for the holidays, and they're going to be sitting at their dinner tables. And I'm sure if another event doesn't happen before then, there's still plenty to talk about some of the ones that happened before. So how do you advise, as a white ally, other white allies to engage with family and community? So put us there in the moment. The conversation comes up, Black Lives Matter, and we know exactly what some of the responses are going to be. What are the moves that you would advise allies to make to more or less open up the conversation to some of the things that Mychal's just talked about?
Well, great question. And let me just ask a question to the room. Who here has tweeted something about the past year and a half or two or three years since Trayvon? Who here has tweeted something about what's happened in this country? Raise your hand. Or Facebooked or Instagram or Snapchatted. Who here has used the term Black Lives Matter hashtag on some form of social media? Who here considers themselves, who here has marched in New York City after the non-indictment of Officer Pantaleo? So I think if we look in the room, we see a wide range of races in terms of who has been involved. I think my best advice for allyship, and I actually take it a step further, I think it would be more than allies, I think it would be accomplices. And there's one thing, an allyship says you have to go first, right? So it's putting the onus on Black people to say, you go first and I'm gonna support you when you go first. But sometimes we have to step first in our own spaces, right? So when we are at our dinner tables over Thanksgiving, we have to step first and have those conversations with our mothers or our fathers or our cousins or our uncles. And so I think the first step for me in terms of doing this work, I do a lot of work with teachers, white teachers around the country, around racial equity leadership, of being a leader on racial equity. And the first thing that I'd ask the white people in this room is, who in your life of a person of color holds you accountable to the work? And if you don't have somebody, ask yourself why. It's not because you're necessarily a bad person. You may not know any people of color in your lives that can hold you accountable. If you don't have somebody, seek somebody out. Someone who can hold you accountable to your work. And the second question I'd ask is, who in your life who's white can hold you accountable to the work? So first having, you know, white people, we don't want to have any accountability. We talk about white supremacy, Mychal, and we say, well, we weren't around back then. But I damn well have benefited from slavery, because we still see the benefits today. So if I'm gonna take the benefits of slavery, yes, my great-grandparents were immigrants from Eastern Europe in the 1900s, So we weren't here during slavery, but I'm benefiting today from white supremacy. So I'm taking the benefits of white supremacy. I have to talk about it with my own community. So I think the first step when you go home is, who are you holding accountable in your life as a white person in your own personal life, and who's holding you accountable to the work? That'd be the first step that I'd offer, and then we can come to class and have another advice after that.
So I'm going to build on some of the comments that both Michaels have made about democracy, and come around to you, Maya. So there, as you heard from Mychal, there is a sense that there's been an investment in electoral politics, and then a frustration that investment hasn't necessarily paid off. You've been both outside and inside. So now that you have a vantage point from the inside, what is it that you think constituencies could understand better about how politics works, how elected representatives can or cannot move in response to some of the demands that are being made on the street?
Yeah, I want to say one quick thing first, because I agree with DS on the issue of course, all lives matter, and the analysis with why it's so important to say Black Lives Matter. And I think we actually have to make this much more complex, because actually, really, the way we created racial exclusion was around trying to debate who was white. We actually have periods of time in this country where Irish Catholics were treated virtually as badly as Black folk. And when we, even in the Virginia colony, we had a period in which chattel slavery was not very much different from indentured servitude, and it was actually a way of creating policy over decades which developed the polarization around anything Black bad and anything white good, and the contestation about who is white, which is not Mychal. So I guess what I wanted to say, though, about this issue, if you fast forward this to today, you know, one of the things that we have to really understand is the left, and I include myself in this, having spent most of my career as an advocate activist, not on this side of the table that I'm on today, we don't sufficiently understand sometimes the electeds are not our allies, but where we have allied electeds, how much support the electeds need in the solutions that can be operationalized into government. Because what happens is, you come into government, there is so much structural and organized either opposition or calcification. And the left thinks, wrongly, I don't mean Mychal, I was one of these people, I should be patting myself. The left thinks that all you have to do is come in as the elected official, and suddenly all you have to wave your hand, and it all changes magically. And the left thinks that, well, because we helped get you elected, which is often true, right, that it required that organizing of the left, that we're done now, and we don't have any actual organizing we have to do to actually get the win external to government. And actually understand what the win can be given how the systems are working. So this is just something that we can, you know, it's hard to make that concrete in a conversation like this, but trust me when I say, and I did not do it sufficiently when I was doing advocacy of where are the revenue streams, what are actually going on in those agencies that are going to make it actually shift, and what is my role externally to being the wind in that sail to help it shift, not just complain because it's not shifting fast enough.
Mm-hmm. So while we're talking then about democracy maybe 201, like, mm-hmm. It's not just electing people, but it's also having an analysis of how to place pressure and the ways to do it. One of the aspects of democracy that we think is important to being able to mobilize is free speech, is protest, is targeted efforts to make change. And I'm wondering whether or how we assess whether that's working in the way that we imagine it. So I think some folks know that Quentin Tarantino, for example, is under tremendous pressure now because of some of the comments that he made in a rally a couple of weeks ago. Now there are concerns that his movie might not do as well, and, you know, it goes on and on. I'm wondering whether that example of an ally who came forward and stepped out, brought his celebrity to the cause, and now is getting pushback such that he may, you know, have to adjust what he had to say. What does it tell us, or what should we think about this in terms of the ability to actually put that pressure on, how the costs are sometimes distributed? I mean, sometimes I look at it, it reminds me of the white citizens councils from like the 60s. What's your sense of it?
Well, I say that I'm white loudly, and that I'm a man loudly, because I want to recognize my privilege first and foremost, and I want white people in this room to know that I am white and to know that I do this work proudly, and that, but my life isn't at risk, right? Then I'm going to walk out of this institution, and I'm not going to worry about a police officer hurting me this afternoon or this evening. So I want to be very, I know we like to joke about it, but I want to be very, very clear. For me, I talk about my race first because I think in this country, as Mychal said, race is first. Right, race, before we get to class, before we get to gender, we get race first. And so if I look at these comments or freedom of speech, one thing I would say to Mychal and Maya's point about why this moment, I think this device is the game changer, right? And you see the FBI director and you see the DEA director talking about the Ferguson effect because cops are now worried about getting, you know, filmed on YouTube. Well, they should be worried, right? Because if they're not doing anything wrong, they shouldn't be worried. But if they're doing something wrong, they should be worried. And so if we look at American history, and I was a theater major, so don't quote me, but if we look at American history, and we're in the School of Journalism, America has changed greatly when communication has changed greatly. From the Pony Express to the radio of the 1930s, when FDR would speak to the American people, and you could hear the president's voice for the first time, to the 1960 debate between Nixon and Kennedy, with his first televised debate, to the 2008 debate between Obama and McCain, the YouTube debate. And so now we're in the age of the internet, in the age of mobile, in the age of social media, where young people in this room, and I would like to include myself in that category, that we don't need traditional media to tell our stories anymore, and you're seeing that. So when something happens in Ferguson, the first thing I went to when I saw, you know, an unarmed teenager killed by the police in Ferguson, the first thing I went to was Twitter. That was the first place I went to get my information. If there's a rally tonight, I'm going to Twitter to follow it, to watch it. I see some folks in the room who might be live streaming. I'm a live streamer. I'm watching his live stream. So this, to me, is the game changer. And so the Donald Trumps who are kicking Jorge Ramos's out of his press conferences or saying we don't want to do a Telemundo, you know, the Republicans, we don't do a Telemundo debate, like those days are going to be over, and they're kicking and screaming while young people are saying we are now have power to tell our own stories, whether you like it or not, and we're going to force you to put it on national television or on the front page of the newspapers.
So I'm gonna go to you, DSO, and I see you're winding up to say something, so I'm gonna let you say it, but let me throw this question on top of it. So we're talking about the media and this breakthrough, but at the same time, it's still there, right? So the whole Ferguson effect was largely made possible by the media really, you know, blowing it up. And now we see yesterday that one of the main cases that they were using to show Ferguson effect was in fact an officer who committed suicide. So how do you assess, on one hand, the opening of Twitter and our ability to tell our own stories with the mainstream media that continues to push a certain frame?
I want to address Quentin Tarantino very quickly, though,
yes.
Because as much as he's been a culture vulture, it's about time he showed up for us. And I think that that's something important to note, is that he will face consequences for this, and that's what it looks like to show up for us. You have to be willing to lose. You have to be willing. This is why we don't use ally anymore, and we say accomplice, because you got to be willing to be in the fight. And it's going to be backlash, and you are going to lose out monetarily, like your social status, all of that. And it's about, are you willing to do it? And if you're not willing to do it, then your commitment to undoing the system of white supremacy is not, I question it, right? And so that's just what I wanted to say there. To the question about like media and like Twitter has democratized the way in which we get information. And people will talk about like, oh, it's you know, these accounts from people that you're not able to trust or whatever. It's about as good as the mainstream media is in getting sort of reporting out things. You know, you have initial reports and then later you get the correct information. That's about how it works at like NBC and whatever Twitter feed that you follow. But media is addicted to narratives, and they're addicted to narratives that comfort them and they're familiar with. So yes, you're gonna talk about the Ferguson effect, because the Ferguson effect then reifies the idea of black on black crime being something that is like the most prescient issue that we need to talk about, right? Because now you're talking about like, oh, if the police aren't doing their job, then black people are just gonna start killing each other left and right. And then we can talk about that some more, right? And just do it without any sort of context whatsoever. So that's why that becomes something, that becomes a hook for people in the media, because they just, people in the media are lazy. they just rely on the existing narrative that like fits into the column box or the television segment. Like we have a very specific conservative like medium, and then we can't open it up to new narratives because they challenge just the way that we've told stories for so long.
So there's both the question about inability to open up to new narratives and I guess discomfort with old narratives. So the other part of this title was Charleston. Mm-hmm. It seems as though Charleston has just faded from our conversation. We're still talking about many of the police killings, but after the funeral and after Bree Newsom brought down the Confederate flag, that conversation is pretty much over. Yeah. And I'm wondering what we think about that, the why of it, the consequence of that. Should it concern us that we really can't talk about 9 black people being killed while they're praying by a person who was born in the 1990s? We're not talking about somebody who was around and part of the Klan in the 60s. This is, you know, bred in this moment in this particular century.
In Charleston, you have the perfect villain and the perfect victims.
Right?
I mean, this is exactly what people think racism in America looks like. And that's what made it so uncomfortable. That's why people wanted to forget about it, because they wanted to believe that it doesn't exist in this way anymore. They wanted to believe that that was a fringe thing. They wanted to believe that we had expunged that from our DNA, but we didn't. It's right there in your face. But I think the other part of that is sort of the forgiveness narrative, right? Is that, and this is no, like, I'm not knocking any of the families for their decision to forgive. Like, that's their decision. But once they did, and did so publicly, it gave the rest of America permission to look away.
Yeah. Maya, what's your sense of that?
I view it differently. One, I don't think it's over. So I reject the notion that what Charleston represented is not something we're still talking about. Even if we're not talking about the specific event of Charleston, we're sitting here today because we're still talking about the issue of race in America, the violence that's perpetrated as a result of it, and the fact that it's a continuing issue in how we deal with it. And I think if we look at all of these issues, what Charleston actually represents that I think is somewhat different and more complicated. I completely agree with DS that it's about clear, easy victims, clear, easy villain. It was also resolution in the sense that, remember, the part of the demands that came out of it was get the Confederate flag down, and there was victory. So the question is, what are the solutions that we are driving? Because I don't think the solutions themselves, it involves symbol, but it does not end with symbol. It starts with symbol and ends with the policies that actually start to shift our relationships to one another as a nation. We have plenty of examples in this country about how critical policies are. Without policies, we didn't create the middle class. By the way, we created a mostly white middle class because they were racialized policies. When we came out of the Civil Rights Movement, we were creating policies that actually were starting to create a black and Latino middle class. We started looking at reparations for Japanese after internment. I mean, these were all policies of creating opportunities that would start to ensure that we could no longer look at poverty, exclusion, lack of ability to participate in democracy, and see it by race. So we're not done, and I would say the fights that we're seeing, for instance, on voting rights is a critical example of it. I don't see Charleston as gone. I think it's about how we transform the examples about how fluent we still are in our racialization in this country and how we look to the policies that transform it.
So, Mychal, what thoughts do you have about Charleston?
I have a lot. So the first thing that happened on Charleston, the first news conference, go back and watch that tape at 11 o'clock at night, the mayor of Charleston, Democrat, and the police commissioner, they come out, the first thing they say, before they even know where the kid is, he's a lone wolf. That's the first thing they say. On my grandfather's grave, you're gonna watch the tape, he's a lone wolf. As if he acted alone, and he was all by himself, and nothing influenced him to go kill 9 black people, because now he's a lone wolf. That was the narrative, right? Now, let me go to the flip side, and Maya's my dear friend, so let me, with privilege, let me criticize my mayor for a second. Not you, Maya. You're off the hook. We marched 50,000 people in the street against the non-indictment of Officer Pantaleo. After the march on the Brooklyn Bridge, 2 officers allegedly get assaulted, right? And we don't know who it is. Now the movement becomes violent. 4 days later, 2 officers get murdered in Brooklyn. Now we're cop killers. Now the language is changing of who we are as a movement. Now we are attached to those lone wolves. But they're not lone wolves, they're attached to us. So now we're one movement. Whether we killed a cop or assaulted a cop or marched peacefully, we're all one. And we hear Scott Walker in Wisconsin tell the president to apologize because he's the one who got that officer killed and turned out the officer committed suicide. Right? Just last week or 2 weeks ago, officer gets murdered again here in New York. Horrible. Horrible. But now we got to change our entire criminal justice system because one guy killed one cop. Now we have a conversation about diversion courts work and drug courts work. And now mayor wants to go to Albany and change the law. So Dylan Roof was in my 5th grade class. Not literally, Barbara, but was in my 5th grade class. But I know that young man. He was in our high school. He was in your high school. He sat next to you. He might have went to the prom with you. He might have hung out after the football game with you. He's not a lone wolf. He's in my circle of friends. Whether I want to believe that or not, whether I want to accept that or not, he is connected to me, he is connected to the history of this country, he is connected to white supremacy, and so am I. So we so easily can connect black people to an entire movement, but white people are lone wolves, and they're not connected to anything. There's no accountability for us as white people to him. He's racist, we're not. He's bad, we're good. I'm an ally, he killed 9 black people, he's not me, I don't have to think about it. So I take just as much responsibility for that as I do for the black man who kills the cop in Harlem. Sorry.
Maya.
So I agree with the substance of all that Mychal said, and I am going to defend our mayor, and he's our mayor. He's not my mayor. He's my boss, but that's different. Because none of that narrative was driven by this mayor. In fact, the mayor's narrative was deep distress and being disturbed by the video that he saw. On the day he saw it, before there was an investigation or result, he made sure and clear that the processes that he is bound to by law, the city went through as expeditiously as possible. The city has no control over the grand jury, and we made demands around grand jury reform as well as reforms around independent prosecutor. So I would say if you actually check the record on the policies that the mayor has championed, it started with Eric Garner and has continued, whether it's about bringing bail reform laws to protect public safety, coupled with the things that we need to keep all our residents safe, no matter their race. So I will say that because I also will say that elected officials are always, and I think rightly, balancing public safety and how that safety looks across the city. And there is no community that is demanding public safety more than communities of color.
So I'm gonna take this now more broadly before we start to really drill down into what might happen, what kind of reforms are important. I'm gonna throw two questions at UDS. So one, there is a question about whether the roof lone wolf frame should be contested with an idea that this is domestic terrorism. We don't talk about racist violence as domestic terrorism, yet some of the reports suggest that there have been more instances of racist violence that could be considered domestic terrorism than what typically is considered to be terrorism. And these groups aren't necessarily listed, they're not included, they're not investigated. Nothing happens to them anywhere near what happens to groups here in New York, which I'm going to get to in a minute, the spying on and the investigation of Muslim groups, for example. So is the whole notion of terrorism too loaded for us to even think about moving it to talk about domestic terrorism? Is there something to be gained by thinking about this, not just as individuals, but deep structures of organized people, some who are pulling the trigger, but others who are providing the ideology behind the pulling of the trigger?
Yeah, I mean, it's hard for me to sort of name things as terrorism simply because the ways in which the definition shifts so much, right? Because today's freedom fighters become tomorrow's terrorists so often, right? But it's also just the fact that like we have to understand why this violence, why we're not willing to name this violence as something abhorrent, right? We're not willing to interrogate it because violence against Black people is vital to the maintenance of American democracy.
Whoa.
Right? You establish second-class citizenship through these laws that we've been fighting for since we got here. But what you also do is you send messages to communities that you must stay in your place. You must abide by that second-class citizenship. And when you step outside of it, when I see you as becoming a threat, I have to send a message to your to the rest of the community that this is what happens to you. These are the consequences. And that's what the quick deaths are about. Like, it's not that, you know, he kills nine people just out of, and it's just, he's a lone wolf and that's just pure hatred. That is central to American democracy. It is necessary for George Zimmerman to kill Trayvon Martin. It is necessary for the police to kill Michael Brown and leave his body in the streets for 4.5 hours. These are messages to the rest of us that when you step out of place, these are the swift consequences.
So for those who might wonder what you mean by necessary, I wanna add one more question and then ask everybody to give your thoughts on it. We just screened, and I think there's gonna be a screening here on the documentary Panther. Mm-hmm. And in it, J. Edgar Hoover is quoted as saying that law and order is not about justice. Justice is, if anything, it might be, you know, a product down the line of law and order, but law and order in and of itself is the primary directive. It's the thing that makes the country work, and it is the reason that he gave behind COINTELPRO, basically the effort to destroy the civil rights movement, to prevent the emergence of a messiah, et cetera, et cetera. Is that logic limited to that moment in history? Or are there elements of that logic that you think are playing out, either against Black Lives Matter, against Muslim organizations, against protesters in general?
No, I mean, we have, like, again, it goes back to the foundation of what this country is supposed to be about. Excuse me. We mean, the principles of liberty and freedom and all of that, equality, are established for a certain group of people. And then you have a history of people saying, we want a piece of that. We want to also be included in the idea of democracy. We want participation. We want the spoils of this economic system. Like, we want all of that too. And you have the resistance, again, and it's violent repression from a government that has been ensured, has been gifted to an elite white male, like, oligarchy, right? And it's the maintenance of that, and how do you do that? You do it through law and custom, obviously, right? And then people mount movements, and they are able to put cracks in that system, right? And we keep moving forward, we keep struggling, and we keep moving forward to something more, some type of inclusion in that system, right? But when the people in power want to maintain that power, that privilege, everything that comes with it, they find new ways to reinscribe that power. They find new ways around, like, saying race. They find new ways around saying black and discriminating on that basis. But they also continue the old scripts, and part of that is violence.
Maya, so we're talking about new ways of reinscribing power, and then that begets new ways of contesting power. So one of the aspects of the work that you used to do in your earlier incarnation was implicit bias. So how does implicit bias help us just get a toehold in thinking and talking about how racial power continues to be produced, particularly for those who might not have a sense of what implicit bias is? How, what is it, and how have you used it?
Yeah, I think the importance of understanding what this history and this history of policies represents is that it has created for us frameworks of how we actually process information and think about one another. So if communities are racially segregated and impoverished, and racially identifiable as either wealthy and white, or poor and black, or Latino, or Native American for that matter, or terrorists because they're Muslim, right? There are all kinds of ways in which we've created these, through policies that prevent inclusion. What we actually also do is create the mental frameworks for how we understand people, and without even necessarily consciously processing information. So this is the, you know, Brent Staples from the New York Times has the famous story that, you know, our friend Claude Steele has written about in Whistling Vivaldi, where he talks about how he walked as a black man, and this is a black man who wears some nice suits.
Yes.
I didn't know the New York Times paid so well, Brent. But wears some nice suits, walks on the street, very well put together, and he would talk about how white women in particular would cross the street to avoid him when they saw him coming. And what he started to do, unconsciously, by the way, he loves classical music. He found one day he was walking down the street and he's whistling Vivaldi. And he noticed that the white women were not crossing the street to avoid him anymore. I would argue both of those, that is not a conscious act, right? It's a subconscious act. It is unconsciously moving away because for you cognitively, the image of black and violent has been mapped to the creation of communities of extreme poverty and that are, you know, frankly walled off in many inappropriate ways from opportunity. And you see it in media representations over and over and over. And what that produces is even unconsciously that process of fear, right? So that the fact that it is not conscious is a little bit of why I think we need to talk about it very differently. So much of what is inscribed is not at a conscious level. And what that actually should do is create great hope and power for us because it can be undone. And I think that so much of what the opportunity is, and what I would say so much of the fact that who we elect matters is, because I can tell you in this administration, while this may have been my previous life, we have conversations about when and how we use implicit bias to actually retrain our workforce so that they recognize and behave differently when they're interacting with all our residents. And so I think it's actually critically important both how these structures create and recreate the problem psychologically, but also the importance of electoral politics and who we elect and potentially helping to undo them in terms of the policies that we pass and even the institutions that we influence to make it a difference.
And so, Mychal, another framework is institutional or structural racism. So what do you think those frames help people understand about the ongoing nature of racial inequality? So if you use structural or institutional racism, how do you use it to educate, help people understand?
If we went around this room, we asked, what is white culture? We don't think of it that way. We don't think white people have a culture. Right? We talk about black culture all the time, Latino culture all the time, immigrant culture all the time, Middle Eastern culture. But we don't talk about white culture. And ingrained in our culture is the idea of the individual and being individualistic, almost rugged individualism. Right? I did it on my own. I worked really hard. I got here because of my merit, meritocracy, another big part of white culture. This idea that, I deserve to be here because of my merits, nothing to do with white supremacy or structural racism or the history of this country or housing or education or all these things, right? So a lot of times when we look at structures, we oftentimes go to the individual. So as an example, I don't know if Officer Pantaleo is racist or not. I have no idea. He still has a job, but I have no idea whether he's racist or not. I don't know him. And so he's an officer who choked Eric Garner in Staten Island. And we often want to say, fire Officer Pantaleo and our problem is solved. Or get rid of, the officer in Ferguson or the officer in Walter Scott situation in South Carolina. Put him in prison and our problem is solved. But there's a system in policing in this country, not just in the NYPD. Look, I got cut off. NYPD, you get cut off. That's Bill Bratton. I see you, Bill. There's a system, not just NYPD, but in this country of policing that's built in structural racism. That's built on things that Maya talks about with implicit bias, that officers see things, not just because of who they are, because of the policies they're asked to. And that's why, I give a tremendous amount of credit. We supported the mayor from day one. When he was 25 points down, stop and frisk, he knows it's wrong. He's reduced it to a minimal amount. Maya's done incredible work in that office to work on things like implicit bias in the police department. There's amazing things also being done within this administration on those issues to dismantle structural racism. And so the last thing I would say, because I see my sign says stop, every politician, most politicians in America, you ask them, what's the equalizer? They'll say education. Come to Columbia, you'll be okay, right? Education.
That part's true.
Education is the equalizer. But how do we fund education in this country? 1/3 of funding of education in this country is property taxes. And if you look at property in this country, to Michael's point, right? Black people in this country have been considered property. 3/5 a person, property of slavery. Now they're state property, now they're in prison. This idea of property, and then we don't allow and we don't set up any programs for black people or people of color in this country to own property. So education systems still fail. So if I was looking at structural racism, the first thing I would do, disassociate property taxes from funding education. Have a whole new way to fund education where it's equal and fair and equitable, and it's not about where you live and what zip code you're in, of how good your schools are.
So we're going to shortly transition to Q&A. So if you have some questions, please gather at the mic here. And since you've transitioned already into what should be done and took your extra minute to do so, I'm going to move on.
That's my whiteness right there.
So Maya, it's about solutions at this point. So give us a sense of what is possible.
There is so much possible. So one, and actually Mychal just laid out a really good one. I totally agree with that one. We have to be thinking much more actively about what our revenue streams are. And look, we have an opportunity that we have not had before in this country, because not just in New York, but we have so many more progressive mayors and cities who actually are talking about raising revenues to invest in our people. That is actually, used to be, politicians couldn't talk about that, and there's still way too many who won't. But that's actually an opportunity. We need to be collectively demanding the revenue that cities, states, federal government creates in order to invest in people. Because at the end of the day, whether it was the Social Security Act of 1935, whether it was the GI Bill, whether it's funding for public education, all of these opportunities that created the opportunities we see that far too many of our members of our communities don't necessarily have, it's because they didn't get those investments. This is an opportunity to demand that we create the revenue streams for those investments. And we literally have a presidential election, which is a really good opportunity to do that. But I would also say that we have so many other forms of solutions that we can do right now. You know, we're really proud of the fact that we created universal pre-K. No, is education everything? No. But let me tell you what it meant to say we will put our money on the table for every child in the city to have a universal pre-K seat. Because not only is it about educational opportunity, we've saved low-income families $10,000 a year in child care. Child care is one of the top three costs that are impoverishing families today because their wages aren't high enough. So while we're also fighting to raise wages and looking at every lever we have to raise wages, and look, how long ago it was only 2 years ago where it looked like $15 an hour was ridiculous. That's no longer ridiculous as a political demand, right? And that's because of organizing and advocacy and the fact that we also had electives that would jump on that bandwagon. But I say that because creating those forms of public programs that ensure no matter your zip code and no matter where you live and no matter what you look like, you're going to have the same services and investments in you that anybody else has. That is critical. We're also creating a budget line for this city, and we're telling other cities they should do it too. We've created a budget line where we're actually starting to get free broadband access to NYCHA residents. All right? Like, this is why it matters. At the end of the day, it's all about taking our resources, growing them, and spending them where people are most in need.
So, DS, there's a conversation and a term floating about that. Seems like it comes out of history, abolitionism. And there was a time that abolitionism was seen as pie in the sky, radical crazies who wanted to completely disrupt our socioeconomic policing system, and yet at the end of the day, their vision eventually came true. So how do you think about abolitionism in today's political environment?
So I very much appreciate folks like Maya who do sort of pragmatic, practical work that like is very tangible and real, and you can see it right now, because that's not where I think. You know, I'm very much like I want to imagine what's quote unquote impossible, right? And everything that Maya is saying is part of what I like to imagine would lead us to a place of abolition. And when I say abolition, I'm talking specifically about police and prisons, right? Because I don't believe, like you can't convince me that institutions born of repression can then be instruments of justice. I don't see a place in a just world for institutions that, I mean, we talk about police in this country, like they are, the first police forces are slave catchers, and then the forces in the North that are supposed to squash labor rebellions, right? So they are repressive forces by nature. So what I want to imagine then with an abolitionist framework is how then do you provide for people safe communities? How do you provide how do you end violence without the use of police and prisons? How do we imagine that world? And there are things that Maya's talking about. We're talking about education. We're talking about investments in eliminating poverty. Like, Raising wages is great. Universal basic income would be better. You know, Obamacare is good. Universal health care would be better, because these are things that you invest in first and foremost to establish a just world. Because these are the things that we know in communities eliminate the risk of violence that we're so concerned about, particularly like the violence that, you know, police are not able to address properly. And that extends to like things, issues of like intimate partner violence and sexual violence. Police are not good at handling those situations. So how do we invest in ending those things without the use of police and prisons as a sort of punishment mechanism, but invest in a just world to begin with, establishing a baseline of equality and justice? And that's what abolition to me means. It's a framework of thinking through these things without the repressive state.
So thank you all for your visions. And so it has prompted questions and comments. So I'm going to take three at a time, and I'm going to ask you to keep it to 30 seconds. And we do have some timers up here. So let's see if we can get through all these questions.
Hi. Okay, I'll talk really fast. My name is Rosie. I'm from the School of Social Work.
Speak loud and directly into the mic.
Hello. Yes. So the title of this conference is Awakening Our Democracy, based on the notion that it is possible to awaken our political system. And yet, as you all have noted, this democratic system is predicated off of patterns and histories of violence against black bodies, right, and oppression. So also now we live in a day and age where our police force is the most militarized that it has ever been. And when we, as citizens, question and say, like, hey, wait a minute, this system still is not working for us, that doesn't sound like democracy to me when that is enforced by a military. And so my question for you is, is this democracy awakenable? Is that possible? And I think some of you have different opinions on that. Do we live in a democracy, and is it awakenable?
Okay, thank you. Two more questions. That's kind of a model, but like maybe a little shorter. So next question, please.
Hi, I'm Roger Peters. I'm a producer, but I'm studying film here as well. You mentioned the courageous woman who tore the flag down. And during that controversy, I learned from Congressman Jim Clyburn of South Carolina that that flag never flew in South Carolina. Very few people seem to know this. Every regiment had its own battle flag. That flag is the flag of Northern Virginia. And everyone who says, and the same is true in Alabama and Mississippi and North Carolina, everyone says, my ancestors fought and died under that flag. They don't know their history. That was only adopted in the 60s as a symbol of anti-racism and of racism and anti-civil rights movement. I think that's important. He said it's a fraud. Everyone stands up and says, this is my flag. It ain't true.
All right. Thank you. Yeah. Next question or comment.
Hi, my name's Ko, and I go here at Columbia Journalism School. So part of our democracy is based on like First Amendment rights and freedom of speech. So as a journalist, traditionally speaking, we're trained to be unbiased, but however, like as we've seen an unfair coverage of African Americans in the media, like in Katrina and in Ferguson, the media doesn't always achieve that. So do you think that it's the responsibility of young black journalists specifically to sort of counter that narrative? And if so, how can we do that when news organizations hire us staggeringly less? Thanks.
Perfect, and under the wire, thank you. All right, now, our challenge is quick responses, so. Who would like to take any of those questions?
We do have a democracy. It's an evolving one, and it has been evolving for centuries, and it's still evolving. And our job is to continue its evolution. And I think that's important, because unless we recognize it ain't all bad, y'all. I mean, look how far we've come. So I don't believe we create a new world by blowing the one we're in up, because then we're not in the world. I believe we do. We have the big vision that Michael's talking about. I do believe vision is critical and important, and I think then we find the smart incremental steps towards that evolution.
Michael Diaz, any responses?
Yeah, I would have titled it something different. I mean, we kind of have a democracy a little bit. Kind of, sort of. To the question of media, God, don't ever buy into that bullshit about unbiased. Like everyone comes to the table with their own biases. And it's about who are we hiring and what biases do they have. But that's what's the beauty of social media and Twitter and Facebook is the creation of your own media, blogs, all of that stuff. Like, these are really powerful tools in disseminating information and countering the narratives of mainstream media. But also, like, it's about to end because Obama's about to get out of office, but we've had like a glut of like black people getting prominent positions within the media now, but it's going to end because Obama's going to be out of office and they just won't care about us anymore because we're not going to talk about these issues anymore. But it really is like we're in a moment where you have to take advantage. We have to all take advantage of that. And like I, from my perch at The Nation, am so grateful to have that and have the space to be able to think through all of these ideas that I want to talk through. But a lot of people are like see themselves more as sort of traditional journalists. I am not a journalist per se. I'm a person with an opinion, an activist, an advocate, and I happen to be able to write. Like that's my tool. Not everyone looks at themselves that way. And the bigger thing would then to be like, how are we teaching the next generation who are going to be entering into these institutions and giving them a perspective and giving them the tools to be able to be media literate? Yeah.
Okay. A few more.
Sure. My name's Lauren. I'm at the School of Public Health. I have two quick questions. How do we resolve the fact that implicit bias, that concept, seems to let certain people off the hook? I didn't know what I was doing. But the people upon whom it's perpetrated absolutely know what's happening to them. We know what it feels like to be subtly discriminated against. It's in our faces. And my second question is the way that structural violence occurs through the lens of gender. Just this week, Vice News released a documentary on their website about women that were raped and murdered in the city of Cleveland. These women had families. The survivors reported their rapes. The man's house smelt like decomp for years, and they weren't investigated. They were not investigated.
Two more.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for an interesting panel. My question was a little bit about connecting the struggles of a repressive state with the fact that we have some climate-related real threshold limits to what's going to happen to the globe, and if you might have a discussion to offer us in terms of how we connect to other very marginalized people across the globe who are at the forefront of suffering from climate injustice, and your question about if we are to re-educate or reinvest in education, for example, here at Columbia, there's the divestment campaign from fossil fuels, and how might that be leverage for, I think Professor Crenshaw mentioned it, but how might that be considered abolition as well, getting rid of the current economy that is based on exploiting many things?
Last question.
Hi, Maya. This question is more specifically for you, but is the mayor's office considering any policy initiatives to restrict the use of bail or the assignation of bail for people who are brought to the court for nonviolent crimes? Because the use of bail as a tool to keep low-income and impoverished people in jail is an issue important to me.
Okay, great. So we have a couple minutes to get your answers to these questions and your summaries. And I want to tag on to one of the questions about gender, the question of intersectionality, which we didn't get to. And before I do that, I want to try something. I want everybody to hold up your hand, and when you hear a name that you don't recognize, put your hand down. So everybody put a hand up. Okay, Eric Garner, Mychal Brown, Tamir Rice, Trayvon Martin, Michelle Casso, Tanisha Anderson, Megan Hockaday, Maya Hall, Okay, so we have four hands left. These are all women who were killed within the last year, along with men who were killed within the last year. If we don't know their names, how are we going to say their names? And if we don't say their names, how is this movement for police accountability going to be remotely able to address all the ways that black bodies are subject to police violence? So I'm going to start with you, DS, and move down with your responses and your final comments.
That is critically important. Just in terms of, one, a movement that isn't inclusive isn't addressing all of the underlying factors of oppression, right? Like, if we're not talking about the ways in which particularly black women are assaulted through police violence, then we're not talking about the ways in which the state then reinscribes ideas of sexual violence and sexual deviance of black women, particularly like the ways in which black trans women are arrested for manifesting prostitution and stuff like that, like for simply existing. Like, we're not addressing sort of, again, the intersections of identity and the ways in which these systems are interlocking. And then we can understand that they're interlocking and then sort of believe then that the dismantling of one will lead to the dismantling of all of them, but that's just not how it works, right? Like, we have to be vigilant in talking about each and every one of those interlocking oppressions and multiple intersections of identity if we want to have a movement that's actually going to be liberatory. Maybe I've sounded pretty pessimistic the entire time, but like, this is my most pessimistic. We're gonna all die from climate change before we get to address white supremacy or anything else. So.
Oh my God, I'm gonna be drinking hard later. The first question on implicit bias. I mean, first of all, implicit bias properly understood and addressed doesn't let anybody off the hook. It's not about off the hook, it's about how do you change things. So number one, the first answer is implicit bias also separates out who's explicitly biased, understands their bias and don't care, from those who actually may not have the bias and not understand it, and there is a power to helping people understand where they are along that. And by the way, it's not just on race, it's on gender, it's on age, right, sexual orientation. So the important thing is to be conscious. To become conscious is the primary mission of trying to understand where people are not conscious. And that's really what we have the opportunity to do. In terms of the question on bail reform, which I'll touch quickly, the short answer is absolutely yes. The truth, what people don't really realize is, right now, obviously we have a huge percentage of the population at Rikers are there because they couldn't afford a very low bail, $500, $1,000, $2,000, and they may sit because of the case backlogs for a year to 2 years, right? We actually don't control that. That's controlled by the DAs who make demands for bail and judges who make independent decisions about what bail to give. So right now we're crowdsourcing ideas on bail reform, our Mayor's Office of Criminal Justice. We're actually thinking about what kind of process to go through to help our judges in our criminal courts understand what they have the power to do. And the district attorneys need to understand that they should not be asking for $250,000 bail for somebody who has no violent offenses and who shows up in court. But that's just a good example of the systems because the city doesn't control all those decisions. But we can think about the ways in which we use our bully pulpit to make those changes, but also to have many more diversionary programs. So we are also investing in more diversion. Climate change, we could talk for a long time, but the short answer is yes. If you look in New York City after Hurricane Sandy, the vast majority of communities hard hit by Sandy were communities that lived under the poverty level. So it actually is intersectional in terms of how people are impacted and how resilient communities are in the face of climate change. And we're actually right now in the city testing hydrogen cars for the city's fleet.
There's a lot there, and I think I'll take the gender violence question. Not talking about women and my mic off. So I think very much in the same way that I believe white people have to come to the table to dismantle structural racism because we are the ones who have benefited from it and also are very much in control of it. I believe men have to come to the table as well when it comes to gender violence. I do a lot of work on that issue and very proud of that work. And so I think if within the university system, right, there's obviously a national case that happened here in this campus, and is still happening here in this campus. And there are, I'm sure, amazing women's groups in this campus that as men, we also can participate and be allies and be accomplices to those groups as well. So I think it's also important for us to show up when we talk about gender violence or violence against women or campus rape or campus assault. I think it's important for us to raise our voices loudly. So to your point about names, and women, and young women. At Global Grind 2009, we started a campaign called He Has a Name, and the first case was Darion Albert, who was killed in Chicago September 25th, right? And we have written thousands of articles of just trying to give young people dignity in their death. And the first sort of big young woman's case we wrote was Ayanna Jones from Detroit, who was killed by the police. And we continue to write thousands of articles, but you know, I'm getting old, and I think of myself sitting in these seats when I was in university in UCLA, and that was almost 20 years ago. And if you rattled off 8 or 10 names of people of color, women or men, there weren't many national names who anyone was talking about because the narrative was just statistics. And a homicide rate, you know, 337 homicide of Chicago, and even Oscar Grant. You know, Amadou Diallo, these were big cases locally, but nationally they just didn't penetrate. And Trayvon Martin was the first name we knew, I believe, since Emmett Till as part of the national discourse. So the fact that you started with this conversation said, we know Eric Garner, we know Tamir Rice, we know Michael Brown. I want to know the names of the living as well. I want to know the names of the young people of color who are living, who are doing incredible things right now as a national, right, the Mychal Denzel Smith as a national name, and we know him, not just those in their, well, maybe not you, Michael, but somebody else. Not just remember the names of those who have been killed, but the next step, for at least for me, is how do we elevate the names of those who are living and who are doing incredible or just doing normal things in their communities or in their schools. And so it's not just about recognizing those in death, but also those in life. So Black Lives Matter is affirmational, and we can proudly say that not just in death, but also in life.
All right. Well, we could go on for quite some time. This is just the tip of the iceberg. Fortunately, this series will continue, so there will be another installment in January of this series. There also will be satellite events across the campus. On November 17th, the law school will pick up this series with a continuing conversation featuring D-Ray, so I hope all of you will join us there. I want to also, as Suzanne mentioned, Barbara Arnwine continues this conversation on her radio show, Igniting Change, and she invites people to call in. It's Tuesdays at noon, and say her name is continuing.
Plugging things?
Go ahead.
Oh, just go pre-order my book.
Oh, yeah, go ahead, do the
call. Amazon.com.
Tell the name of the
it's
book.
It's called Invisible Man, Got the Whole World Watching. Go to Amazon to pre-order it right now.
All right. Anybody got anything else that they want to direct people's attention to?
My son, Mateo Ali, would love some Instagram likes.
All right, Mateo Ali. Gray, Maya?
I hope we all leave here with the notion that we are right to be outraged about the conditions that real people live in this country, and we will be wrong if we drop out.
All right.
There's so much we can do, and I just want to say it's a marathon, not a sprint, y'all.
It's a marathon. And Say Her Name is an ongoing campaign. You can get reports, T-shirts, follow us. Thank you all, and thanks to the 3Ms. Thank you so much.
And before everybody leaves, I want to ask you something which you can take as a request, as an assignment, or as an invitation, whatever inspires you. And that is, we've had an incredible conversation today, and surely you have had many thoughts during the conversation. Join the conversation. Send us your thoughts so we can share them on the University Life website and continue the conversation from event to event. We'll see you in January at the next Awakening Our Democracy. And please join me again in thanking our incredible conversations today.